Amen. Thank you, my dear pastor, your dear wife, and all the ministers in the house, and the Holiness family. As I always say, I look forward to come and be with you. As a matter of fact, this is one of the only places that I come now in the nighttime. I don't go much travel and take night appointments. And thank God for my two sons. They always make time. They walk in, but they will still come, take time off to come. They say, Pastor, we're going to bring you. They love to come here. They feel a part of this church. All right. And I'm doing a lot of personal evangelism back again, Pastor. House to house, along the people give me the opportunity. I am going, dealing with them, praying for the sick, carrying food. And people are accepting the Lord. That is what is all about. It's not a matter of going and visiting and eating, but ministering to them right now. I'm dealing with Brother Roger, mother-in-law, that is very ill. They're Hindus, and he will know that they always appreciate that when Pastor could take time off and come. All right? All right, I'm sure you notice, and I don't have to remind you, the hair is getting gradually falling. Next time I might be, when I come here, Pastor, I might be bald. It's falling at a rapid rate. All right? And people are making all kinds of suggestions. All right? They say, boy, you're looking good. Let me get a little wig for you. Let me get this for you and get that for you. I say, leave me just as I am. And that reminds me of what I told you in the office, Pastor. Lady was very sick. She was 50 years old. I don't know if I shared that with you all last time, Sir Jenny. And somebody told her about the Lord. And she said, Lord, I'm just 50 years old. I want to live. And God said, I'll give you 20 more years. All right? So by 70, all right? And be ready for you. When she heard she getting 20 more years, she did a facelift. She fixed her hair, fixed her nose, and fixed up everything. And in a few years' time, all right, she was crossing the road, and a bus ran over her and killed her. When she appeared before God, she said, God, what's this all about? You tell me 20 more years you'll give me, and it's only 3 more years. How come you stop the bus? God said, I didn't make you out. When I talked to you, you didn't have much hair. Your nose was long, and so I didn't make you out. That's why I didn't stop the bus. But I'm honored to be with you. This past Monday, I held an evangelism seminar in a church. About 6 days, Brother Moose was there with me. So I'm doing a lot of that now. I'm going to churches and teaching them a personal evangelism. In my 40 years as an evangelist, most of my evangelism was mass, right? But I did quite a lot of personal evangelism, which I feel that is most needed now. So I went to the church in the area, all right? And when I go to a church in my area, I don't tell them where my church is located, all right? And so because I don't want nobody to feel like soliciting people to come by me, all right? But I share on personal evangelism, and it was tremendous. I said, what I'm sharing, I didn't get it in any book. It's from personal experience, so I come with a measure of authority. Because what work in England ain't gonna work here, you know. What work in India ain't gonna work here. What work in Africa wouldn't work here. You have to work according to the culture of the people, all right? And so I shared with them, ministered to them, and they said, Pastor, please come back again. And I'm going to talk to Pastor one of these days. I'm going to, at the appropriate time, if I get permission, maybe a Tuesday or so, come and talk about personal evangelism. You don't have to go on the street, right on your job, right in your home, right? And wherever I get the opportunity and the door is open, I always seize upon the opportunity, all right? Gradually, with God's wisdom, share Jesus. And no telling over the years, through my testimony, sharing with the people how many people came to know the Lord. All right? So I am grateful and thankful for that. All right? I won't be with you too long this evening. Like I always say, all right? But I have a word that that I share many times during my ministry. I want to believe even I share that here already in the past. But this message, you can never hear too much of it, because I felt this message is so appropriate, is so needed in such a time like this. Is about forgiveness of sins. People are making much emphasis on that today, all right? And I put a little title for the message, all right? And I'll tell you where it is taken from. No matter how many sins you have committed, when you come to Jesus, you will be accepted and you will not be rejected. That making sense? No matter how many sins you have committed, when you come to Jesus through repentance, you'll be accepted and not be rejected. And I speak on my behalf, all right? Okay, because that is actually what happened to me and many of you. Maybe you fall in that bracket. You came to Jesus, being rejected by society, but yet Jesus accepted you. And I'm highlighting today from Luke chapter 7, all right? It is a well-known incident. Maybe you read it many times, you heard it preach, all right? All right, it is taken from verses 36 to verse 50. I'm not going to read all those verses, all right? All right, it is about a sinful woman who came and anoints the feet of Jesus, all right? It begins from verse 36, all right? So you keep that before you. Luke chapter 7, from verse 36 to verse 50. Keep it right in front of you. I'm going to make reference to some of the verses, all right, as I move along. But it says, and one of the Pharisees desired him, Jesus, that he would eat with him. And he went to the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, and every time the word behold is used in scripture, something marvelous is going to happen. All right, is about to happen. Behold, or may I have your undivided attention? A woman in the city, which was a sinner. All right, people don't want to hear that word sinner. All right, they feel you're condemning. A sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment. All right, watch that. And stood at his feet behind him, weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and wipe them with the hair of her head, and kiss his feet, and anoint them with the ointment. So I'm going to stop right there, but then we're going to pick up verse 49, and it says, and they that sat at meat with him began to say within themselves, who it is that forgiveth sin also? And Jesus said to the woman, thy faith hath saved thee. Go in peace. Because of your trust and your confidence you place in me, all right, you are now different. Now, I was doing a little research about this woman, and I didn't get much information concerning this woman. I didn't get information on her name. I don't know what was her name. The Bible never tells us whether she name was Maria, Sumintra, or whatever it is. It didn't tell us what was her name, all right, or whether she was Jewish or Samaritan, or whatever it is. And I didn't get much information in respect if she had a family, if she had a husband, or if she had children, or she was involved in some kind of business. All right, but to me, she had some money, because to have a box of ointment in those days, all right, they said a box of ointment worth 1 year's salary. So somewhere money was coming from. I don't know if she was working. McDonald's didn't have no place in that time, or she was selling doubles or Sara Roti. I don't know where it is. All right, but she had some money, somehow or the other, to buy this ointment. But the Bible tells us that Jesus was invited to this home for dinner. I was made to understand, according to Bible history, in those days, people never sit like how we sit around the table, but they will spread out their feet on a couch, put their elbow on the table, their feet will be exposed. This is what I read according to history, and they will eat. So their feet will be exposed, all right? And this woman heard that Jesus was in the house of this Pharisee. She was not invited, all right? But the Bible tells us she came to that place. She came there because she was living a life of reproach. Write down the word reproach. All right, reproach. Reproach in the sense because even though she might be successful in whatever she was doing, it did not say she was a prostitute or whatever it is, all right, but her life was filled with sin. And I am not ashamed to say, and I am now not going to give any apologies, right? But if you are living in sin, it's a life of reproach. It's a life of reproach. I'm not going to water down that. I got in trouble in the past already for that, all right? And I'll keep on getting in trouble, right? If your life is in sin, you're living a life of reproach. Her life was one of restriction. Restriction in the sense maybe not of material things, but restriction from the blessings of God. And as long as there is sin in your life and you are living a sinful life, no matter how successful you might be in the secular world, all right, whether it be in business or whatever it is, but you are restricted from the things of God. And the things that God got in store is priceless, is precious. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard the things that God got in store for those who love him. You cannot really put a price tag on the blessings of God. Material things will pass away, for the Bible teaches us we brought nothing into this world, but it is a certain cannot carry out anything. Life does not consist in the abundance of things we have. The only thing that we can bank on and rely on is the blessings of God and the things that God got in store for us. All right? So this woman was living a life of reproach, and because of that, she was restricted because of her sinful life. There are so many needs today in this world. So many needs. You look at the television, and I look at it a lot because it keeps me going. You look at the floods in different areas. People need houses, and every day something going up. People sleeping under trees, sleeping on the pavement, no food, and etc. And even in our own country today, all right, we have a lot of people who have needs, special needs. They keep fixing the road. They're taking money to fix the road. And more money they take, the bigger the hole get in. No, I'm no politician, all right? I want you to know that, but you will agree with me in what I'm saying, right? Things are going up, up, up. And I told somebody, get accustomed of things going up, because one of these days, when we live for the Lord, we're going to go up as well too. All right? All right? But there are so many needs we are confronted with today. In the political arena, people saying the need is change of government, change in the counselor, change in this, change in that. But I am here to declare the greatest need of the hour, whether it be in India, whether it be in Africa, whether it be in Nigeria. I've been to Nigeria, I've been to Malawi, I've been to Mozambique, all right, and some of these, I've been to Norway, and I lecture in some of these biggest places in Norway, in the rehab center. But the greatest need of the hour is for forgiveness of sins. No matter how successful you might be in this world, how people look up to you, and what kind of doctorate you get, all right, and the newscaster calling your name, and you're in the front page of the newspaper, all right, that matters not. What you need today, most of all, is forgiveness of sin. And this woman recognized that, right? She lived a life of reproach and restriction, But she recognized that she had sin in her life, and she got to get rid of that sin. But what did she do, Pastor? Did she went by some Obia person and let her sprinkle something on her? Or give her something to tie on the bedpost? A lot of people, you know, you had people approach me and say, and I find the house shaking, right? Pastor, you have anything you could give me to tie on the bedpost, right? And all kind of foolishness people want to come up with, all right? But this woman, she decided to reach out to Jesus. Write out the word, reach out to Jesus. And reaching out to Jesus was a step in the right direction. You never go wrong reaching out to Jesus. And I will continue to say it, and even though people criticize me and said I'd be lifting up myself, but I cannot stop giving my testimony, brother. In 1967, when that lady called me out and told me about Jesus, and I reached out to him, all right? It was not her that saved me. She was just a vessel. She was just a mouthpiece, all right? God working through her to reach out to me. But she decided to reach out to Jesus. Why she decided to reach out to Jesus? She was not prepared to remain in a sinful condition. And there are a lot of people do not see how important it is to reach out to Jesus. You think about everything in this world, but you still want to remain in a sinful condition. If I start to go to church, if I give my life, I can't do this, I can't do that, and I can't do the other. And a lot of people today, all right, they want to get involved in the things of the world, all right? They miss the pleasure of the world, all right? Why? They want to remain in a sinful condition. They want to remain as a handicap, controlled by the devil. They do not want to reach out to Jesus. The hour has come, dearly beloved, that men need to reach out to Jesus. That's the solution. That is the answer of the hour today. No matter what color of skin you got, or your ethnic background, or what country you come from, the solution to the problem today is reaching out to Jesus. You cannot afford to succeed and progress and flourish if you remain in your sinful condition. Now, I'm preaching as like in my tent, you know, that's the way I used to go, you know, tent evangelism, that's the way I used to operate, Pastor, right? Do not remain in your sinful condition, because you'll be living a life of defeat, a life of restriction, a life of reproach. You will never, never, never enjoy what you have, no matter how well you might succeed in the secular world. And you may flourish and have plenty, but in the sight of God, you're still empty. I want you to know that. So she decided to reach out to Jesus. Why? She was ready to receive forgiveness of sin. Who can tell? Maybe she was one in some of the meetings that Jesus was there, that where Jesus forgave people. Maybe she was reluctant to an extent. Not now, now, boy. I still want to live it up. I'm still young. My body could still move a little bit. All right? I don't want to wait till I get arthritis. All right? And I get this and I get that and the other. But the hour has come. All right? She decided to step out to Jesus. And that was a step in the right direction. She recognized that Jesus was her only hope. And I come to declare today, if I get an opportunity to get back on television, I was on television for 9 years. I met a brother who said he used to record my program. I don't know if he's here tonight. He said, but I remember Channel 2 and 13. Like I told you, I had the biggest audience in those days because only I one channel. You switch me off, you couldn't, you didn't have nobody else, Brother Lyndon, you could have put on the, you know, cable, and this fella and that fella with the cut up jean and all kind of thing. No, 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 no. It's hurry or hurry or no hurry. All right. So it was a step in the right direction. She recognized that Jesus was the only hope. And I am here to declare, amen. While he brought hope to the hopeless, a little more than 2,000 years ago when he walked the dusty streets of Jerusalem, the good news that that same Jesus is still alive. Hallelujah. Amen. What he did in those days, he can do it now and even do it much better. Bless the name of the Lord. We have to remember he's the possessor of all power. Amen. The same yesterday, today, and forever. We have to remember his hands are not shortened, but still outstretched. We have to remember that the blood that was shed on the cross has not lost its power, but that blood, amen, still got working power. Bless the name of the Lord. Amen. There are a lot of people, things have lost its power, but not the blood of Jesus. Hence the reason why the songwriter put it so beautiful that we cannot stop. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. It's not the blood of white fowl. It's not the blood of bulls and goats, but the blood of Jesus. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. That blood is still available. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. It was a step in the right direction because she recognized that Jesus was our only hope. And I am here to declare there is still hope for the hopeless. This world can still change. This world can still progress. This world can still move forward. But we have to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. There's no shortcut. I want you to know that. There's no shortcut. But the only way is through Jesus. But when she came there, all right, recognizing that Jesus is the only hope was a step in the right direction, she decided to demonstrate a level of respect and honor. Bless the name of the Lord. Respect and honor is not that she said, "Good morning, Jesus. How are you doing today?" It was more than that. The Bible tells us she had a box of ointment, alabaster box. And I understand that ointment was valued for a year's wages. So you could imagine how precious. Nobody want to get rid of that. All right, that is that thing you have to use it little by little. All right, you know you have certain perfume expenses. All right, you just touch it a little bit and that is it, right? And you rub it up because you know you can't afford, right? But you know, it was a demonstration of respect and honor. She anointed the feet of Jesus. She broke the box. And I could hear the old devil saying, "Woman, why are you so stupid for? Yeah? You don't know if you go get back any ointment? Why are you wasting that for? Whenever you want to do something tangible for Jesus and you want to give Jesus a level of respect, the devil will always come. Amen. And like we say in colloquial language, chuck your wheel and break your spokes and hinder you. All right? The devil quickly will encourage you to respect and honor earthly people. And we need to give respect to people in this world. Let us not be hypocrites. All right? But why we respect everybody in this world? And we have no respect and honor for God, the one who created us, the one who woke us up this morning. It was not the alarm clock that woke us up. Amen. It was not the one, amen, amen, responsible for food and drink, but what it was him who is responsible for us being here today. He's the author and the giver of life. We need to keep reminding ourselves, amen, because he said, "I come to give life and give it more abundantly." Bless the name of the Lord. It is he who got us here today. Amen. We may not have everything in our favor. The sailing will not always be smooth. We have high points and low points, but we thank God, amen, for life, because he who gave us life. Amen. And so nothing is too much to give to him. She anointed his feet. She wept. She took her hair and wipe. If she do that in this day and time, boy, every newspaper would have her in front. Stupid woman, foolish woman, taking a costly ointment and doing this and doing that and the other. All right? But I want to declare, nothing is too much to give to Jesus. And a lot of us, we don't show honor to the Lord Jesus. We don't appreciate him. According to the principle of his words, we get time for everything and to give to everything and to buy everything. But at least we hold back and we give him the remain. If I have the change, I go give it to him. All right? Listen, folks, we need to appreciate him. We need to respect the Lord. Bless him. Nothing must be too much. Everything you possess today, in all credit, I know you take night and you turn it into day to some people. And like they say, that you turn your blood into water, or water into blood, or whatever it is, all right, to achieve what you have, all right? But I tell you, we have to learn to give honor to whom honor is due. Amen. Can I say something to you today? And I say it from my heart. I used to work for $35 a fortnight. And you know what work I used to do? I used to empty bins and sweep the bank, pastor. I was a janitor. Janitor from the church to janitor in a bank. All right? But I paid my tithes. I give to God what rightly belonged to him. No, pastor didn't tell me to say that, you know. And I ain't pushing nothing today. Look, look, two boys gonna tell you there, right? I talk about it. I don't push nobody. I don't call nobody for nothing by the house. No, I don't do that. I know one pastor say, well, you can't bring it. Leave it by the gate, right? the watchman there, you put it there, the gatekeeper. Put it there, all right? No, I don't. Everybody have their way, all right? But I've learned to respect and give honor to whom honor is due. Nothing is too much to give to God. Give him of your time. We get time to do everything, but we don't appreciate him with our time. The least, if I get time, I go. All right? Appreciate his house. We get time to go by everybody's house. Oh God, pastor, they could tell you to invite me again, you know. And we go and make merry and we spend hours and hours and hours and hours. But come to God's house, me? I'm afraid, boy, I go get COVID. I'm afraid I might drop down. All right? Last resort, the bottom of the list is God's house. Time, our talent. We sing for everybody, we do everything, but we wouldn't sing a song for God. Forget who listening. They want to hear you when you go in your bathroom. You sing, man. Don't worry about nobody, no, man. You sing. Sing unto the Lord. Appreciate him. He's the one who got us here today. He's the one who is responsible for us. When I started the ministry, it took me 6 years, pastor, before could I get behind a pulpit, you know. You see right by Queen Street there? And Frederick Street, the other drugstore, Ross Rockstore, that was my pulpit, boy. Hey, man, I preach in there. And sometimes I sit down and I say, I wonder why I used to preach, boy. Never went to any school of theology, right? I remember a man invited me. I asked a man to preach. He said, well, you go come Sunday and bring your credential, all right? I make a fella write out a piece of paper. I hereby recommend Harry Ramkisoon to preach. I said, I go show him this. And when I go on the pastor, waiting up, I forget the paper. I'm going to call the man name. He was a popular man on television. All right? He was a popular man. He died now. All right? One of the first radio preachers, he died. But he says, since you're here already, right? I go give you a little chance to preach. Well, he gave me a chance, and from that time, for 6 consecutive years, I kept preaching for him. All right? I kept preaching for him. Appreciate him. Don't let nobody brainwash you and say they're taking this and they're taking that, and you had time to go there, and you had time to take time for God. He took time for you. Listen, Jesus gave his life for us. And if a man could give his life for us, why cannot we give our life for his cause? Nothing must be too hard for him to do. And people criticizing me, and I know I can't continue to go, Brother Glenn, continue how I'm going, you know. My knee has hurt me. Food has hurt me. To be honest with you, amen. Why are you sitting and rest yourself? You're getting old. Right? It's 56 years in ministry. I'm now celebrating. Right? I'm going to tell you how old I am, because you know what? You might want to give me $1,000 for every year, but keep it, it's all right. I'm going to tell you, why you behave yourself? As long as I have breath, I ain't staying quiet. Look, two men go tell you here, look, they say, Pastor, what are you going out there? So what are you going by them people for? What are you getting bread for? Up to today, I'm doing that. Why you do? I ain't blowing no trumpet now. Them boys go tell you, look, they're right there. Yeah? Leave them alone. Let it go. Let me do what God want me to do. Amen. Amen. If I cannot go behind the pulpit, let me go by the house. Let me preach. Let me teach. Let me tell them. All right? I want to give my all. Everything I possess belong to Jesus. Nothing I have is for myself, but for him. All right? But when she began to anoint his feet, she was rebuked. Write on the word rebuke. That man says, a prophet. He ain't know who that woman is touching him. Yeah, and doing this and that and the other. She's a sinner. And people will say all kinds of things about you. He will ridicule you. And that's the work of the enemy. To upset you. And if I used to take on people, I never preach today. Never. I give up long time. Because they say you're playing this and you're playing that and you're playing this and you're no Hebrew and you're no Greek. Why want to know that? For I'm no good English self. Greek and Greek and Hebrew and... And they say, yeah, you have no big house, all right? You have old car. Like I tell you, people never want to invite me because Brother Lyndon, I didn't have no jacket. And I tell you, all the white man in the airport going away, the man was about 7 feet tall. And look how white he gave me a jacket when I put it on like a winter coat. But I put it on, boy. I preach. I say, jacket, all you want, take jacket. Take jacket. All right. All right. People will rebuke you. Where are you leaving your house for? They have a good movie tonight. Where are you going to church for? Why you don't stay home? All right? And people lost that desire for corporate worship. People lost that desire. And I know, amen, and I'm nothing wrong looking online, but there's no substitute for congregating in the house of God. I say it and I say it again. David said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of God than to dwell in the tent of wickedness. We must not forsake the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is. All right? Take time. People will rebuke you. People will say, but you walk all day. Why you sit on home and stretch out your foot? Yes, nothing wrong with that. Amen. And I know if you come, look at my empty chairs there. Now you sit down there and you stretch your foot, they pass and go put you out of the church. Amen. But come and hear the word of God. Amen. She was rebuked by the Pharisee. And people will rebuke you. They will reproach you. But don't take them on. That is how the devil operate. All right? To bring reproach. Make you feel that you are disgrace. But when she came to Jesus. Jesus didn't take on that fella. You know, I guess in words like this, I use in my imagination and I'm my rights. You can't stop me. I could hear Jesus saying, "Man, if you want to keep your food here, say your food here, boy, that's your business. Say, leave the woman alone." Right? She was received by Jesus. She didn't worry with this Pharisee fella and say, "Woman, what are you doing here? You're young guy, no invite? What are you doing here? Yeah? Come out this place. This is for special people. I know what it is to go places without being invited, you know. Boy, you couldn't stop me in those days, boy. When I want food, I tell you, oh, it's so good to them wedding. They cooking and I go on asking, and I go on straight by the kitchen and asking for Tulsi. Here, nobody named Tulsi. Tulsi, I say, yeah, I'm a cousin. Right? And while they're looking Tulsi, two pockets full of roti already. And when they can't find Tulsi, it's gone, I gone. full of roti. Right? But what the important thing, she was received by Jesus. You know how heartbreaking it is to go to somebody and they never receive you? Yeah, you ever been in that situation? Who is you? Where you from? They size you up. They look at you. And there's so much prejudice in this world today. In order for people to receive you, they go according to the color of your skin. And I ain't starting no role now or digging any pit hole. But we have to be realistic. It is true. Which village you come from? Who's your grandparents? Right? Where you come from? What you have? What diploma you have before they receive you? But not so with Jesus. He knew this woman was a sinner. Amen. Long before, just like the woman at Jacob's well, he knew, amen, she had many husbands, right? But you see, that's the problem with a lot of us. Instead, we open a conversation, we start with condemnation, and we turn off people. And that is one of the things I'm preaching with. Don't go to people and start condemning people. If I come up here with a big box of doubles, I say, Ali doubles are good. Harry doubles are good. Henry doubles are good. Joshua doubles are good. By the time I'm talking about all that, I change your mind and doubles. When I'm ready to sell doubles, you don't want no doubles. You go on. You leave me with all my doubles. I poison your mind already. Do not start with condemnation. Jesus, what he did, he received the woman. When he received the woman, he repaired her life. Write down the word repair. Repair her life. Today, I take a car, Suzuki, I had a little cut in it. So I go and buy a tire, please sell a new tire. Say, fella, this tire boy, like, he only going on. He say, Mister, stop right here. Let me check it out for you. He jack it up, put in a barrel of water. He said, this tire have a little hole, boy. I didn't have to buy no tire. What do you do? He repaired the tire. So now I have a repair tire, all right? It is the same way when you come to Jesus. He won't ask you how many sins you have committed, how much money you thief. I tell people, if the lady who tell me about Jesus in George Street Market, 1967, I believe in restitution, right? You know, Zacchaeus said, if I've taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. If Jesus had asked me how much fowl or thief and how much goat, pastor, I'd be preaching until I walk in with a stick to buy back goat to give people and buy fowl. Amen. I was now telling pastor, I preached in Brooklyn Tabernacle some years ago. I show him the thing there. I was preaching in Grass Trace in Curep. And look, Mo's laughing, you know, because I took him to kindergarten school. While preaching, pastor, big crowd. While preaching in Torrance Pub, I hear cock crowing. Oh, 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 oh. I said, but then people have no respect. I'm on preaching. When I don't preach and I come out, it's Calvin, it's Punka, all of them. I used to thief fall with them. So while I'm preaching, they're crowing. You know when you're preaching and you get a good point, you say amen? Yeah? Them crowing like fowl. I preach in Brooklyn Tabernacle and Pastor Jim Simler, I mentioned that he started rolling the ground and he laughed. Amen. When you come to Jesus, no matter how many wrongs you have done, he won't tell you right or wrong, and I go see what I could come up with. And I go see what the moment you're ready to repent, he's ready to repair and forgive. Isn't that right, Pastor? The moment you're ready to repair and ask for forgiveness, no, he said, he that cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast out. In John chapter 6, he will receive you. So don't let the devil confuse you and tell you, you have done too much wrong. You have gone too far. You're cursed too much. God ain't had time for you. Look at the prodigal son, broke the heart of his father. You read that story? Give the man sleepless nights. I could imagine the man couldn't sleep, the father. But when he come home, he didn't say, look, write down where you do with all the money, and then I go see what I could do. All right? He put a robe on his back. Modern day father would have put a good crook stick on his back. Shoes on his feet. A modern day father would have him in casualty going like that. Ring on his finger. No. Father kissed him. And that is what God wants you to do. Amen. But you must be willing to make the move. You must be willing to come. You must be willing to put your pride aside. And that's the problem with a lot of people today. They got too much pride. They do not want to humble. They're studying what the neighbor will say. They're studying what the fellow worker will say. All right. The church brainwash you. The preacher said this and that. Forget what people will say. The Bible says the end. Every man will have to stand and give an account of his own self. Amen. There is a judgment coming. I will not be judged for you, but you have to be judged by yourself. Every man will have to give an account of his own self. All right? She was restored. Write down the word restored. And she was redeemed. Bless the name. I love that song. Redeem how I love to proclaim it. Amen. She was taken dirty and made clean. Her sins was forgiven. Jesus is saying loud and clear in Matthew 11:28, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That rest is not just sleep, but rest from the hands of the enemy and from the wickedness the enemy got you involved in. Set you free. Break the yokes and break the chains. I remember in 1967, I repeated that short prayer after that lady. Amen. And when I got up, was no big time prayer. I know what it is to walk like that, you know, when I used to smoke my weed. But when I got up, I felt like chains was broken. I felt liberated. I felt transformed, redeemed. Bless the name of the Lord. I want to tell you, that's the Jesus I am talking about. Can take you dirty and make you clean. Bless the name of the Lord. She was restored. She was redeemed. What he said, your sins are forgiven. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. When she left Jesus, she returned as a different person. Oh, no man that come to the Lord in true repentance, no woman confessing your sins will go back the same. Amen. But you go back different. Closing the message right now, Pastor. Ready to pray, man. Ready to pray. She returned a different person. I guess the people in the community, I don't know what she was involved in. Forget that. I don't want to go today. Oh, you're looking so different, girl. Oh, you're talking so different. Amen. What happened? She met Jesus. I'm not saying that when you become, give your life to the Lord, you come dirty, you go back clean. You come as a sinner, you go back forgiven. I'm not saying you will not make mistakes. Pastor, a lot of things I did in the past, if I have the opportunity to do it, I will do it differently. A lot of things I said in the past, if I have the opportunity, I will say it different. Amen. You have no angel wings. You will still make mistake. You're still on earth. Amen. But the good thing about it, you are connected to Jesus. Amen. You're redeemed. You're born again. No matter what you have done wrong, you got power to forgive sins. I close this message to tell you today, beloved, there's hope for the hopeless and there's help for the helpless. No matter how dirty you might be, no matter how far you have gone, the arms of Jesus is still open. What he did when he was on earth, he's still on earth. Because his presence is here today. He said, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am in the midst. He can still do it. Stop listening to the devil. Tell the devil he's a liar. He come but to rob, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus said, I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. So forget what people saying about you. Don't let the devil disturb you and pollute you. No matter how many sins you have committed, there's room at the cross. At the cross, where I first saw the light. And that light is not that light, but the true light that no man could out. What I like about that light, amen. You could have the light, and you have no light bill to pay. Bless the name of the Lord. So I'm ready to pray. I'm ready to pray. Bless the Lord. No matter how many sins you have committed, if you come to Jesus, you will not be rejected, but you will be accepted. I want to come down a little bit here today. It's getting a little more difficult for me, you know, Pastor, but that's all right. You don't know Jesus. You never asked him to come in your life. The devil is telling you, continue, go on, live. How are you going? You're all right. You're all right at all. You're only all right when you have a relationship with Jesus. Relationship brings benefits. God got a store back full of benefits for you. But you got to develop a relationship. You may not have a box alabaster tonight, a bottle of oil or whatever it is. But just as you are, broken, empty, battered, bruised, confused, you hear the good news. Jesus ready. If there's a mother or a father, a son or daughter, a neighbor, whoever you are tonight, I ain't gonna push you down, you know. I ain't gonna slap you and work any magic on you. I just want to pray with you. Amen. Get ready to repent. Get ready to receive him. He's standing here tonight with his arms open, ready to say, welcome home, daughter. Welcome home, son. If there's any tonight, just lift up your hand. You want that special prayer of forgiveness tonight. Just slip it up, wherever you are. God bless you, my dear friend. Stand to your feet. Go pray with you. Come. Come, daddy. Come, stand up right here. Come. Stand up right here. Right. My dear friend in the back here, come. I know there are many of you, you got loved ones that you're concerned about them. If you have a husband, you have a wife, member of family, a fellow worker, school, whoever it is that you're concerned about tonight, that you want the Lord to reach them. God cannot, there's no distance in prayer. I want you to lift up your hand on their behalf tonight. I see that working Prince's song, you know. Yes, I tell you, I was preaching in the tent Thursday night, talking about 18 years ago for Reverend Torrance Bob. I said, anybody want to pray for their loved one? A lady said, yeah, pray for my sister in Toko. What's half past eight. I pray next night. Say, preacher, I want to tell you something. My sister called me today, Friday. I say, half past eight, she was sleeping and something rolled she off the bed. I want nobody roll off the bed and bust the head and thing. I don't want that happen. He said, and God began to speak to me. And that is the very same hour we started to pray. And she gave her heart to the Lord. There's no distance in prayer. You have a loved one that's not saved? Lift up the hand. Thank you, Father. Thank you tonight. Thank you tonight. Take your right hand. Put it on the left side by your heart. Yes. Don't feel bad in doing that. Oh, glory to God. Say, Lord Jesus, I come to you in true repentance. I believe you got power to forgive sins. You paid the price for my sins. Please forgive me. Break those yokes. Set me free. Put you first place in my life as my Lord. In Jesus' name. Lord, those who are standing tonight with their hand lifted for their loved ones, Lord, touch that husband right now. Touch that father. Touch that mother. Touch that grandmother. Touch that fellow worker. Touch that boss, that maxi taxi driver, that neighbor, whoever they are. Oh God, I pray that you're going to break those yokes right now. And I decree and declare complete deliverance in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I pray for divine healing tonight. If you're sick, put your hands where you feel sick tonight. We all go through that pain. We're not exempt yet. I have my situation myself. Father, thank you for Jesus, your son. He's a doctor of doctors. He's a great physician. We decree and declare by his stripes, we were healed tonight. Every sickness must go in the name of Jesus. Replace that pain with gain. Oh God, I pray for encouragement. Those who are discouraged, touch them right now. Lord, in the name of Jesus, those who are weak, give them strength. Those who have lost a desire to come back to the house of God, bring them back, oh God. Restore them. Those who have fallen, lift them up, for you're not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. Continue to bless all our people tonight. Our needs will be met, Lord. Lord, you are the supplier, all right, of our needs. Yes, you prepared a table in the wilderness, Lord, and you could prepare a table for us. You will never allow us to go hungry. We depend upon you. You will never allow us to walk naked. Every need will be met, for we cast all our cares upon you, because you care it for us. Bless all your people tonight. Bless our pastor. Oh God, touch him. Bless his wife in a special way. Bless this ministry that will continue to be a lighthouse in this community. And I thank you for my brethren today. I give you praise. I give you thanks. I give you honor. And I give you glory. Give the Lord a hand of praise, somebody. Hallelujah. Us.
spiritually, you may be seated.